In this video, we're going to talk about adding and subtracting fractions. Now, the main thing you need to remember about adding and subtracting fractions is that in order to add two fractions or subtract two fractions, the denominators must match each other. And if they do, then the process is very straightforward. I'll give you an example. If you had 2/5 plus 1/5, when the denominators match together, then the arithmetic happens in the numerator, and you would just take 2 plus 1, and that would be your new numerator, which is 3, and you would keep your common denominator of 5. 2/5 plus 1/5 would equal 3/5. Well, it gets a little trickier when the denominators don't match each other. Here's what we have to do. If the denominators do not match, we need to force those denominators to match. We're going to use something called the least common multiple. Now, there's a couple of different ways that you can find the least common multiple. One's a little informal and one's a little bit more formal. In the vast majority of cases that you'll run into, the informal way of finding the LCM will work just fine. Now, we'll actually have a video coming up after this one where we talk about how to find the least common multiple in the more formal way as well. But in this video, we're going to do the slightly more informal way. Let me show you how it works with an example. Let's say we had 3/4 plus 1/6. Well, right now we can't add these because the denominators don't agree with one another. So what we need is the least common multiple of these denominators 4 and 6. So first of all, what is a least common multiple? It's the smallest number that you can have that's both a multiple of 4 and a multiple of 6. So for example, 8. 8's a multiple of 4, but 8 is not a multiple of 6. You could take something like 24. 24 is a multiple of 4 and it's a multiple of 6, but it's not the lowest common multiple that we can have. For this one, I think it's actually 12, and here's how I know that. The informal way of finding a least common multiple is to start with the larger of the two numbers and then start adding multiples of that on top of itself until you find one that's also a multiple of the other number. So all of these, if I take 6 and then 12 and then 12 and 6 more make 18 and 6 more make 24 and 6 more make 30, all of these are multiples of 6 because I just keep taking larger and larger multiples of 6. But I'm going to start looking in this list and I'm going to stop when I find somebody who is also a multiple of 4. 6 is not a multiple of 4, but 12 is. Done. We found it. And so that's all you do. You start with the larger of the two numbers and you keep taking larger and larger multiples of that with an eye on the smaller number, and you keep asking yourself, is this a multiple of the other number? Is this one? Is this one? And you should run across it pretty quickly. So the least common multiple of 4 and 6 will be 12. Now, when does this not work so well? Well, if you have two really big numbers, then it can get really cumbersome with this technique. But you know, if you look in your algebra textbook and you look through all the exercises, the vast majority will be 4s and 6s and 15s and 12s, and they're not going to be very big numbers in the hundreds and whatnot. So for the vast majority cases, this is just fine. So now, once we find the LCM, what are we supposed to do with it? Well, we're going to actually force both denominators to look like 12. And I know this is possible because 12 is a multiple of 4 and 12 is a multiple of 6. That's why we chose it. So let's ask ourselves, 4 times what would give us 12? Well, 4 times 3 would give us 12. So I'm going to multiply the denominator by 3. And remember, I also need to multiply the numerator by 3. Now, why can I do this and why does this not change things? Well, I'll ask you this. What's 3 over 3? Well, 3 over 3 is 1, and when you multiply anything times 1, it won't change the quantity. It might change the way that it looks, but it won't change the meaning of it. Now, what do I have to multiply 6 by to get 12? Well, I think 2. And so I'll multiply numerator and denominator by 2, and this is going to give us two new fractions. The first one, you'll get 9 over 12. That's 3 times 3 over 3 times 4. And let me stop for a minute. let's be very clear. 9 over 12 is the same as 3 over 4. It's the same ratio. It just looks a little bit different. It has a different denominator. And the second fraction will be 2 over 12. 2 times 1 over 2 times 6. And so 2 over 12 is the same as 1 over 6. But this has an added bonus. What's the bonus of writing it this way? Well, we have the same denominator now. So this is what we do. If the denominators do not match each other, we force them to match using the least common multiple. Once that's done, everything's downhill from there. 9 over 12 plus 2 over 12. If the denominators match, the arithmetic happens in the numerator. And so we would get 11 over 12 for our final answer. All right, let's wrap up with one more example. Let's say we have 5 over 14 minus 11 over 7. The denominators do not match, so I'll take 14 and I'll take 7, and I'll start with the larger one, and I'll keep making a list of multiples of 14, 14, 28, so on and so forth, and I'm going to stop when I get somebody who's a multiple of 7 as well. Well, we're done. The very first term, 14. 14 is a multiple of 7. So 14 is going to be my least common multiple of these two denominators. So I'll take 7 times 2 to get 14. And I also need to take 11 times 2. I don't have to do anything with the first fraction because it already has a denominator of 14. So this would be the same as 5 over 14 minus 22 over 14. I have a common denominator now, so I can proceed with the algebra. Let's see, the arithmetic happens in the numerator. 5 minus 22 is negative 17 divided by the common denominator of 14, and we're finished. So hopefully that helps you better understand how to add and subtract fractions that have different denominators.